I am Beverly Morgan Welch. I am the Senior Deputy Director for External Affairs at the Museum of Modern Art. I am a proud member of the Class of 1974. And honored to be a member of the Board of Trustees. I kind of think I've been busy being bold. And I know you have too. It is my privilege to welcome you to MoMA. Smithies and Smith devotees, I'm here this evening because President Kathy McCartney saw me and heard me and asked me. I am humbled by her leadership over this last decade, of which you will hear much. And now it is my pleasure to introduce someone I love dearly, along with so many of you, but Vice President for Alumni Relations, Denise Wingate Mater, Class of 74.
Good evening, and it is my pleasure, along with Beverly, to welcome all of you here tonight as we come for a very special event celebrating the remarkable presidency of Kathleen McCartney. So as you've heard, I'm a proud member of the Class of 1974, and I have been so honored to serve as your Vice President for Alumni Relations now for the past 3.5 years. I am so thrilled that we are here tonight. I'm thrilled to be here with you and for all of us to finally be able to be here in person, because there's one thing I'm absolutely certain of. There is nothing better than a room full of Smithies and their friends to feed the soul and set the world right. It's so exciting for us to finally be person to person in the same space where we can share our stories, where we can greet each other and feel our own very special kind of energy. My Smith family, you lift my spirit. But tonight we are here for a very special occasion, and that is to honor our beloved president. Kathy, as she is known around campus, has been an exceptional leader. From my own experience as a member of her cabinet, I can tell you, and you already know this, that's why you're here tonight, Kathy is extraordinary. She has been an outstanding president to move our great college forward, to strengthen us at the core, and to elevate Smith's status as one of the leading liberal arts colleges in the world. And the Smith community has wholeheartedly embraced Kathy since the start of her presidency. Students especially love her, and her love for them is as compelling. Kathy's impact has been felt far beyond the Great Court Cates. In the past 10 years, she has logged thousands of miles crisscrossing the globe to get to know us. Her belief in the power of the Smith Alum Network, the connections that we have to Smith and to each other, is evident in so many ways. Whether she's visiting clubs, hosting teas, inviting, and many of you have been, as alums coming to campus to speak and mentor our students, she celebrates you when you're there. And for those of us who've been back for reunion recently, or will be in the next 2 weeks, you know Kathy knows how to host an unforgettable party. This, my Smith friends, is the essence of Kathy. She believes deeply in the power of the liberal arts, in the Smith experience, and in the capacity of Smithies to change the world and make it better. I am delighted that you are here with us tonight to celebrate her legacy. This is a magical moment for all of us. It's a time to look back. It's a time to reminisce. It's a time to consider where we've been and, yes, where we're going. There is so much to tell. Wait for it, because there's going to be so much to share. And indeed, so much to be proud of. But before we hear from Kathy, I would like to now ask Allison Overseth, a proud alumna and the current chair of the Smith College Board of Trustees, to please come to the stage now so Allison, you can offer your own special insights and introductory remarks. Thank you.
Good evening, fellow Smithies. I'm Allison Overseth, a proud member of the class of 1980, current chair of the Smith College Board of Trustees, Baldwin House. Yeah. This is an extraordinary evening. I have to say thank you again, Beverly. This is just remarkable. My pride in Smith and in Smithies is overflowing. We are a remarkable community, and no matter how much time passes or how much distance there is between us, the fact remains, our enthusiasm and love for Smith and for one another never diminishes. Before I welcome Kathy to the stage, I want to take just a moment to reflect on Smith's exciting evolution under the exceptional leadership of our president, Kathleen McCartney. There's so much to admire about Kathy. She came to Smith 10 years ago with a clear and compelling vision, and she's achieved it all. And as I've come to learn, apparently college presidents are often divided between the visionaries and the implementers, and we had both with Kathy. At her inauguration, she talked about access and affordability, about innovation and smart risk-taking, about community and connection, about balancing the curriculum with the co-curriculum, and providing one-of-a-kind experiences that build students' character, expands their perspectives, and prepare them to lead lives of promise and distinction. Today, thanks to Kathy's hard work, collaborative spirit, and big thinking, Smith is more selective, more welcoming, more financially secure, and more cutting-edge than at any time in our history. In the higher education landscape, Smith is the envy of our peers. I also have to mention that Kathy's experience as a developmental psychology has been incredibly helpful. She understands the complexities of human interaction and the needs of students as they learn and grow. She communicates with both heart and mind. That ability was no more evident than in the leadership she displayed throughout the pandemic, one of the most challenging moments for any college presidency. I remember the first day of my term as board chair, July 1st, 2020. We are still in the early months of the pandemic, moving cautiously towards an uncertain fall semester. At 9:30 that night, I get a text from Kathy. You still up? So we were on the phone 5 minutes later and talking about the recent data, concern about the students, imagining how we both do what the college does well in terms of educating students, but also keeping everyone safe. Kathy's extraordinary care for the community, her concern for the health and well-being of students and faculty and staff was overwhelming. In difficult moments, you need empathy. In that moment, Kathy chose to lead with love. This, my fellow Smithies, is Kathy's philosophy in a nutshell. Bring your best self, and together we can accomplish anything. Many of you know that Kathy has a daily gratitude practice. For the past 10 years, she's been thanking all of us for our support, for our generosity, for our enduring love of a college that played such a transformative role in our lives. Now it's our turn to express our thanks and gratitude to Kathy for 10 years of service to Smith, for being bold, for strengthening our college in innumerable ways, and for reminding us how incredible it is to be a Smithie. Kathy, you have been a terrific partner, a trusted confidant, a true visionary, and a dear friend. On behalf of all of us tonight, thank you for stewarding Sophia Smith's legacy and our great college with such thoughtfulness, dignity, care, and grace. Our future is so bright because of your leadership. Everyone, please join me in welcoming our amazing president, Kathleen McCartney.
Thank you so much. Beverly, Denise, Allison, thank you for your kind words, which mean so much to me. It's always wonderful to be in the company of the New York alums because you care so deeply about your alma mater. Tonight is obviously a special night for me, but also for Smith. This is the final stop in my goodbye tour as I complete 10 years as president of Smith College, and I want to acknowledge some very special guests. My family is here, my children, press, Caitlin and Kimberly. My sisters are here, Susan and Jeannie, with their husbands, Eric and John. Thank you for being here. And my husband, Bill, is here, but more about him later. No one does this work alone, so many of my senior team members are here too, and I'm going to, I want you to know who they are. Floyd Chung is here, Vice President for Equity and Inclusion. David DeSwart is here, Executive Vice President for Finance and Administration. Samantha Earp, Vice President for Information Technology. Denise Mater, Class of 74, Vice President for Alumni Relations. Joanna May, Vice President for Enrollment. Joanna Olin, Chief of Staff and Senior Advisor to the President. Beth Raffel, Senior Vice President for Alumni Relations and Development. Michael Thurston, Provost and Dean of the Faculty. And Julia Yeager, Vice President for College Relations and Communications. So, I've planned to walk down memory lane. How does that sound? Okay with you? This really is a story about our shared ambitions. This is a story about our successes. And for me, this is primarily a story about our partnership, because without the engaged, caring, and generous alums of Smith College, none of this would have been possible. And I'm so glad my family is here tonight to see how wild and crazy you really are. The best part of my job has been spending time with alums across the world. I remember my very first year, there were 12 alumni events across the country, and you treated me kind of like tonight, as if I were a rock star. Remember the first New York event at the Yale Club? Yes. I had to choke back tears. And Lois Perelson Groves, I have your handkerchief just in case I do tonight. You love this college, and your president is the happy beneficiary of all that love. I know you will be just as amazing when you welcome Sarah Willie LeBreton. You know, you might think that yellow or blue is our color, but it is white. And you know who knew that? Sarah and me, the day we met. She is terrific. We are already good friends, and I look forward to attending her inauguration in October, and I hope I'll see many of you there. Alums, you really are a force in every way. You live up to Sophia Smith's dream that graduates of her namesake college would use their education to do the most good to the greatest number. And together, we have done so much to make Smith stronger and secure its future, and that is what tonight is all about. It is about what we collectively have done. Now, let me tell you a little bit about the work of a college president. First, I suspect you won't be surprised to hear me say that being the president of Smith College for the past 10 years has been the greatest honor of my professional life. And being the first gentleman of Smith College has been a great honor for my husband, Bill. I love this photo from our inauguration. You know, the students from the quad came to get us, to walk us from the president's house to the ITT. And somebody snapped this picture, and you can see the two of us are looking, it's like such a couple's moment, isn't it? We knew we were starting an amazing new chapter in our lives. Now, as a student, I didn't have the opportunity to live on campus. I think most of you know I'm the first in my family to attend college, and I lived at home. Yeah, go first gens, right? But I was so excited to live among the students. which I do, I sometimes joke with the students and with all of you that I live in the best house on campus. There it is. Now, sometimes people will say to me, but you live right in the middle of campus. Isn't it loud? And I always reply, why, yes. Yes, it is. Primal Scream is coming up soon. Now, I know if you're like Alice and you think it's Baldwin House, or maybe you think it's Chapin House, but or Tyler, but trust me when I tell you, this is really the best house on campus, and Bill and I have made it our home in every possible way. We have so many wonderful memories. I'm just going to share a few. We have welcomed honored guests, as you know, especially our commencement speakers like Oprah Winfrey. There I am with Oprah Winfrey. Nancy Pelosi, I had the honor of interviewing her. The amazing poet Joe Harjo. And my first commencement speaker, Ruth Simmons. I also have wonderful memories of choosing the perfect day for Mountain Day. Now you might be wondering, why am I showing you a wedding photo? Well, this was taken in 2017, and Nate Durr from the biology department tweeted out that he and his bride, Shannon Audley from the education department, were gonna get married on Mountain Day. So I wrote him and I said, are you truly gonna let me choose your wedding day? He said yes. They literally got married in my backyard, and I was there. One of my favorite memories, though, of all 10 years is announcing our no loans policy. This is truly one of the proudest days of my professional life, and I know the trustees who voted to do this felt the same way. After the vote, we were on our feet clapping for ourselves and tearing up, knowing we were changing lives for the better. And of course, Bill and I have many memories of walking the beautiful Smith campus. This is my favorite tree, which just happens to be a ginkgo tree, and if you know me, you know why that's my favorite tree. So it loses all of its leaves in one day. Look at that. It's like a blanket of yellow leaves. And then there are the students, the reason the college exists. I love to attend student events, like research conferences, basketball games. Did you hear we made the Final Four this year? There's Coach Lynn Hersey, and she was named the National Coach of the Year for Division III. One of the students she is coaching, number 22, is senior Morgan Morrison. She was named National Player of the Year for Division III, and they are both Smith people. Bill and I have also attended wonderful dance concerts, plays. We love hosting teas at the President's House. Here's one. And we love hosting Trick or Treat. Now, guess who I am? I am Sophia Smith, that's exactly right. Next up, I'm not gonna make you guess, that is Bill and me as the oldest Bert and Mary Poppins to ever dress up for Halloween. And this past year, a student came to the door and she said, guess who I am? And I said, oh my God, are you me? She said yes, but she was outdone on Friday night by the Smith College Board of Trustees. I don't have a photo for you, but there were 30 people, including 3 men, wearing blonde wigs and wearing glasses just like mine. I've also had the pleasure of serving as a guest lecturer in many classes, like in Alice Hurst's government class, I've talked about foster care. In Ben Balmer's statistical and data sciences class, I've talked about the logic of hypothesis testing because I too taught statistics. And in Catherine Clement's psychology class, I've lectured about the effects of childcare, which is one of the things I used to study as a professor. So year after year, I watch our students prepare themselves for lives of distinction and purpose. This is our mission. This is our work. And this is our honor. Trust me when I tell you, we are in the business of changing lives. And I'm going to tell you about a couple of lives we've changed. I remember a student who was very shy as a first year. And by her fourth year, I was attending one of those dance recitals. And she was dancing for all she was worth. At the intermission, her mom came up to me and she said, "You can't believe how much she has changed." And I just listened to her mother, but I know how much she's changed because I'd watched her grow. One of my strongest memories comes from the end of my first year, where an Ada Comstock scholar came to my office hours, and she shared her educational journey with me. She started off at a community college, like many Adas, and her guidance counselor told her she wasn't smart enough to go to Smith College. But he was wrong. She was. And she graduated magna cum laude. My favorite student of all time worked at the President's House, so I knew her well. Like me, she came from a humble background, but today she is a very successful engineer. And she's here with me tonight, and at dinner we'll sit with my family. Essence White, where are you? Can you just give a wave? Let's move on to all we have accomplished together. If you're wondering about this busy being bold business, the title of my inauguration speech was Busy Being Born, and that line comes from a Bob Dylan song. Dylan wrote, "He not busy, being born is busy dying." And of course, Dylan meant that we need to change in order to grow, in order to develop. And so do our institutions. So Smith has changed, and I think together we have been busy being bold. So let's start with one of the things I'm most proud of. Applications have increased, wait for it, 122% in 10 years. That's more than double. We received almost 10,000 applications this year, and next year's class will be the most selective in our history. When I came, the admit rate was 43%. This year, 19%. So I want to give a special shout out to those of you who are alum admissions coordinators. You interview prospective students for us, and you represent Smith at local college fairs and yield events. So your work has made a difference. Yeah. Yeah, keep up the good work, because we're not done yet. I think one of the reasons that students are applying to Smith is they know we invest in our students. We invest through financial aid. This past year, we have awarded more than $90 million in financial aid. And again, at this point going forward, none of our students will leave Smith with any loans whatsoever because we've replaced them with grants. We've also invested in equalizing the student experience, and let me tell you what I mean about that. For example, we are giving first-year students from families with fewer economic resources $1,000 startup grants, and that money will help them transition to college. So they can use those monies to buy whatever they need. It might be a computer, or it might be a winter coat. We've also eliminated fees for activities, for music lessons, for studio art, for chemistry courses, and more. No more fees. Next, I want to tell you about the important work we're doing on equity and inclusion. If you've been reading my letters, then you know that advancing equity and inclusion is among the most consequential work that we are doing together. Every department, like physics, every unit, like the Shock Center or the museum, or the Botanic Gardens, they are all engaged in setting goals and achieving those goals through actions. And just last week, we had a summit where people came and they shared what they're doing and why they're doing it so that we could learn from one another. We've also created funding opportunities for students, staff, and faculty. So if anyone has a good idea about how to make Smith more inclusive, we're funding them with grants up to $10,000. And as Floyd Chung and I like to say, This work will not be done until everyone has the same sense of belonging. We've hired more faculty of color, like the amazing Loretta Ross. You may know that last fall she received a MacArthur Fellowship, which is commonly referred to as the Genius Award. She's amazing. And we've hosted so many prominent speakers as part of the Presidential Colloquium Speaker. Mazrin Banaji came, I think, my second year. She's a professor at Harvard University, and she is the one who invented the term implicit bias. She did a 3-hour workshop for students, staff, and faculty. Brian Stevenson zoomed in with us during the pandemic. You probably know he is the founder of the Equal Justice Initiative, and he gave a colloquium on his book, Just Mercy, which was also made into a film. Maybe you've seen it. And just last week, we hosted Ta-Nehisi Coates, American author and journalist, and boy, what a moment that was. We have new academic programs. We've created new majors in data sciences and Middle Eastern studies. We've created new tracks in ethics and biogeology, new concentrations in journalism and collaborative innovations. We created a writing and public discourse program using funds from the Mellon Foundation, and our students are writing and publishing op-eds in places like Ms. Magazine. And we've added more research opportunities, especially for students majoring in the humanities and the social sciences. And then there's the co-curriculum. And when we say co-curriculum, we mean everything that happens outside of classes. We created the Jill Kurt Conway Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship. We listened to alums who believe that Smith should do more to encourage women to enter careers in business, and we raised a $15 million endowment to the center, thanks to many of you who are in this room today, including our lead donor, who's been anonymous up until this moment, but our lead donor said I could reveal her identity, Elizabeth Miller, and I hope she's here, but if she isn't, she's on her way back from London, so she'll be here momentarily. We also expanded the Wordle Center for Work and Life. It is now the Wordle Center for Leadership. Margaret Wordle is here, but I won't make her stand up because she wouldn't like it. We created an office for the arts. And we endowed our Poetry Center. It is now the Boutelle Day Poetry Center. We have a $10 million endowment for it, which includes funding for an endowed professorship. So on July 1, the poet Yona Harvey will be joining the faculty. And this makes me so happy because I'm a great lover of poetry. And now this center is secure with core funding. One of the last big things we're doing has to do with career development. We are reimagining the Lazarus Center for Career Development as a 4-year experience for each student. And Shelley Lazarus is here, so thank you, Shelley, for getting us started. I think it's really going to be best in class in career development at Smith. Let me tell you why. We have 1-credit courses in things like designing your path or critical perspectives in entrepreneurship that students can take, but they can also take workshops, things like storytelling for influence or Wall Street prep. And we're building career communities. So there's one in STEM, there's another in government and law, another in business and finance, a 4th in arts and communication, and the 5th, my field, education and the nonprofit sector. So students will be able to meet with a counselor who understands their sector and meet with other students who are interested in that sector. And that's not all. Every Smith student now receives a paid internship, $3,500, that they can take anywhere if they're interested in art museums. They could come to MoMA and they don't need any funding. They bring their own. And soon we will have a wonderful new building that will house the Lazarus Center and the Wordle Center. Our goal is to ensure that every Smith student has the skills, experience, and mentoring to succeed in any career field in an increasingly complex world. We have many pride points, too, with respect to our work on sustainability. In 2019, we had our year on climate change with the goal of raising awareness and promoting positive change at Smith. And let me tell you about some of that positive change. We joined the Real Food Challenge, which means 20% of our food meets sustainability and fairness standards, and that number is increasing every year. We created a landscape master plan that will minimize our carbon footprint. We collaborated with Amherst, Bowdoin, Hampshire, and Williams to build a solar farm that now supplies 30% of our electricity. And I want you to know that, yeah. Smith and Hampshire took the lead on that. But last April, and maybe you heard, the Board of Trustees approved a geothermal energy project that will allow us to reach carbon neutrality by 2030. And not with offsets, real carbon neutrality. It's incredible. There have also been very exciting capital projects. The first building I was a part of was the Shock Center for Health and Wellness, and that's thanks to a very generous gift from Nancy and Hank Schott. And then, as you might have heard, we transformed Nielsen Library, designed by Maya Lin. This is the amphitheater, which Lyle Gibbons funded. Lyle is here tonight. Thank you. This is the foyer. It's what you see when you come in. It's this beautiful oculus that goes all the way up to the fourth floor, and maybe you can see the sculpture on the wall across from the oculus. That's a Maya Lin sculpture. And finally, this is the Gloria Steinem Special Collections Reading Room that overlooks Alumni Gym. Isn't that a gorgeous photograph? We are renovating Alumni House. It is almost done. This is a rendering, but by reunion, every item on the punch list will be done. Denise and Beth Raffeld are already in that building with their teams. We built new Friedman Apartments at the end of Paradise Road, and they are spectacular. We built a new boathouse. My daughter Kimberly was a rower, so she's not going to be surprised. I was an easy mark when the AD said, "Can we build a new boathouse?" Like, sure. And we created the Happy Chase Garden right next to the President's House. It's named for Beatrice Happy Chase, class of 1924, and it is indeed a happy place. The faculty and staff tell me they've changed their walking routes so that they can pass by this garden during every season. It's absolutely beautiful. Let me tell you a little bit about our finances. In the last 10 years, the endowment has grown by 58%. We now have $2.5 billion in our endowment. We brought the management of the endowment in-house because women know how to manage money all by themselves, right? But we're doing it. And we created an advisory committee for investor responsibility to consider matters of social responsibility in the endowment. As a result of their work, we have ended investments in fossil fuel managers. Now, I have to tell you how, you know Smithies are great organizers, right? But I want to tell you how effective Divest Smith was. You see that big heart? They came to my office one Valentine's Day and said, "President McCartney, be our Valentine, divest Smith." And when they met with the trustees, they were just as persuasive. Debbie Dakotas, who is here, chaired that group, and after hearing presentations from this group, we decided that they were incredibly right about it all. Alumni engagement. I have to tell you, Ivy Day is my favorite day of the year. It really is. Mountain Day is a close second, but Ivy Day is the best year. So what has Denise been busy being bold doing? Well, she and her team have created an app called The Network to connect alums everywhere. And if you're not on this app, this is a shameless commercial for it. So you need to get on the app. Denise and her team have also been engaged in very innovative programming. There we are in May 2020, when the pandemic was, 2 months old, and you might remember we had global illuminations. Alums across the world sent in photos of themselves lighting a lantern for the class of 2020. We won awards for that. Denise also held virtual reunions and career and professional development webinars, so we tried our best to keep you connected during the pandemic, and one of the things we learned is that you actually really like these webinars. You don't have to come to campus all the time, so we're going to keep doing it. And finally, we created the Smith Business Network for alums with a national board. There they are meeting last fall. Denise Mater, stand up and be recognized for your great work right now. I got to tell you, I first met Denise in Colorado at a Smith Club event, and at the end of our conversation, I said, "Are you movable?" And she was, and I'm so glad for it. And again, I want to say something about the alums who that very first year helped me understand that Smith needed to do more to promote careers for women in business. We have had a three-pronged approach, and I've told you about all three, but now I'm going to put them all together for you. The Jill Kerr Conway Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship, with the largest business competition in probably the world, but in the country, for women entrepreneurs. The winner gets $25,000 and a chance to work with an accelerator. Our new career development work, and finally, the Alumni Business Network. This is very, very powerful. How did we do all this? With fundraising. And I want to tell you how you've helped me, be busy being bold. First of all, we received a $50 million gift, which is the largest gift, not only in Smith's history, but for any women's college, not that I'm competitive or anything. We raised $189.3 million for endowed scholarships because this is something near and dear to my heart. I want to make it possible for every single aspiring student to attend Smith with generous financial aid. We raised $52 million for the library, the most for any building project in Smith's history. And this makes me perhaps the most proud. Over the past 10 years, nearly 25,000 alums, nearly half, have made a gift to the Smith Fund. And this really reflects the power of collective giving. Every gift matters, every donor is counted. So since July 2013, when I arrived on campus with my partner Beth Raffeld, we have raised $710.9 million. Here she is, Beth Raffeld, everybody. And for the last seven semesters, we've been living through a pandemic. We just kept moving forward. And I'm just so proud of my team, who I've introduced, and the Board of Trustees, and all of you. We just kept moving forward. So how did we do it? Innovative faculty, dedicated staff that we're honoring, audacious students with an abundance of ideas, trust me. Alums who are engaged, caring, and generous, and there you are, class of 65. And I want to give a shout out to some other people. If you have served on the Alumni Association or the Board of Trustees, please stand up now and be recognized. Please. You want to know how amazing you are? From the Board of Trustees, Marsha McHarg is here from Germany, Debbie Berger's here from Hawaii, and Peggy Liu is here from Hong Kong for this event. Alums, let me tell you everything you do to keep Smith strong, because there's so much. You're club leaders, right? There's 200 Smith clubs across the world. And you foster alumni engagement through those clubs. You're class leaders who promote connection and shape successful reunions. As I already said, you're alum admission coordinators who ensure strong enrollment, but that's not all. You're members of development groups. We couldn't have had our very successful Women for the World campaign, and there we are at the close, without you. You're members of Friends Advisory Groups, Friends of Athletics, Friends of the Libraries, Friends of Museum, Friends of the Botanic Gardens. You are the philanthropists who fuel our dreams. You can have all the vision in the world, and it doesn't matter a whit unless you have partners, and I have had the best partners. These are the three presidents of the Alumni Association of Smith College that have served alongside me during the past 10 years, Kate Grant, Susan Green, who's here tonight, and Peggy Kuhn. Susan, please stand up so we can thank you. Next, I want to thank the three board chairs with whom I have served. This won't surprise you. All three of them are here tonight. Betty Evyard, Debbie Duncan, and Allison Overseth. Now, if you asked them, they would say that serving the college is a labor of love, and they enjoyed every minute of it. And they did, I think. But still, these three women deserve our profound gratitude, and I cannot imagine better partners. I want to thank them for their ambition for Smith. I want to thank them for their wise counsel, and I want to thank them for their support of me personally. As Allison told you, sometimes you get a late-night text or phone call from me. So without these three visionary board chairs, Smith wouldn't have been able to be busy being bold. We wouldn't have had a successful completion of the Women for the World campaign. We wouldn't have a library that is a work of art as well as the intellectual heart of the campus. We wouldn't have our incredible no loan policy. We wouldn't have had our geothermal project and so much more. Now there's one more volunteer I want to thank with my whole heart, and that is my husband, Bill Hagen, the first gentleman of Smith College. This is the first time he's heard this talk, so he doesn't know what I'm going to say. So there are three things I want to say to Bill. First, Bill, thank you for everything you do for Smith. We have hosted more than 500 events at the President's House. Not that I'm counting or anything. We have attended countless colloquia and student events. We've traveled across the country and the world for Smith. Second, I want to thank Bill for taking good care of me. As you can imagine, he's helped me think through thorny issues almost every night over dinner. He learned how to cook during the early days of the pandemic when we were all doing 12-hour days. And Bill did so many errands. God is my witness, I have not been to the pharmacy or dry cleaners in 10 years. It's really true. And Bill, thank you for loving Smith as much as I do. It was about a month ago that we were eating in the breakfast room. Only the Smith President's House could have a room called the breakfast room, right? It's really a small dining room. It overlooks the pond. And Bill said to me, how are we ever going to leave this place? So how do you leave a job that you love? I have been wondering about this during my last bittersweet year, and I've come up with three pieces of advice for myself. The first piece is to remember all the good times, and there were so many. I've shared a few with you tonight, but truly, I could fill volumes with happy memories. The second piece of advice to myself is to savor the loss. The more you love a place, the harder it should be to leave, and Smith will be a very hard place to leave. As you know, I'm a child psychologist, so perhaps it is fitting at this moment for me to quote Winnie the Pooh's take on saying goodbye. Winnie said, "How lucky I am to have something that makes saying goodbye so hard. How lucky indeed." They call me K-Mac. It's kind of like J-Lo, only different. They really do call me that, though. Anyway, the third piece of advice is that Bill and I hope to spend more time with five very special people in our lives, our grandchildren. They await us. I have to tell you, though, Tessa, who's the one in the pink in the front, came to a basketball game this year and went crazy. And at the end, she said, "I don't want you to retire." And I said, "Why? I'm going to live near you. I'm going to be able to spend more time with you." And she said, "I want to go to Smith, and I want you to be the president when I go to Smith." Let it be so. So Sophia Smith envisioned her college as a perennial blessing to the world. Of all the things she said, that's the one that resonates with me most. I use this phrase in almost every talk I have given, because to me what it says is that Smith really is a sacred place. And trust me when I tell you, it has been a blessing in my life. I'm so grateful to each and every one of you for being here tonight and for supporting me on my leadership journey. Thank you for being here. Thank you so much for everything. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.